Recorded Books presents The Flying Horse by Sarah Maslin Nir. Narrated by me. To the Real Grandma Frida. Chapter 1. Trendy. It was one of those dawns full of stillness. Winter had just taken off her overcoat, but spring had not yet flounced in. There was the silence of songbirds who overslept, bundled under down and cozy. The birds seemed unwilling to wake and warble into the still, chill morning air. The little horse, however, was wide awake. Everything was just too exciting. You, too, would find even that quiet, quiet morning thrilling if it was your very first day on planet Earth. And indeed, the nut-brown foal, curled in a not-quite ball under tumbles of crisp straw, had just arrived here, and he was determined to see the world. He'd been scrabbling to stand for the better part of an hour with little luck, if only he could make his body listen. He took a breath. He needed a new strategy. Maybe just try two hooves at a time? With a heave, he scrambled his rear legs to a standing position and, aha, held them there. Two of those wobbly, fuzzy sticks folded underneath him were suddenly uncrumpled. He was up. Well, the back pair of legs were, at least. The front half of his body still lay in the warm straw. But the brief sense of accomplishment the hours-old foal felt was fleeting. It was all so tiring. But he would not fall down again. Instead, half propped up, he took a breather. In the still dark corner of the big birthing stall, his mother was dozing. Olina's coat was several shades darker than her new son's. Her belly had been so round as she'd grown the foal inside her over the last 11 months that she'd more than earned her nickname around the farm, Cocoa Bean. For Olina, it had been a long night, laboring over this, her maiden or first foal. Though it was hard work, she had been very quiet, and the baby was a few weeks early, so the humans who took care of her had not been expecting him. They were still asleep in their beds in the farmhouse at the top of the hill. They'd missed the arrival of the little furry jewel now struggling in the hay. Olina had not been worried. Instinctively, she had known what to do. She lay down at points to help him turn inside her, then stood when she felt the baby shift into the position foals must take to be born, nose pointed toward their toes, chin over their knees, hooves pointed forward, a perfect swan dive straight to earth. After her hard work, she had dozed off, standing, as horses do, and now turned her head to see what the commotion by her hooves was all about. Her long forelock fell halfway over a sleepy eye. She snorted. The little foal was determined to stand, even if his new body was refusing to cooperate. It seemed he had reached a compromise with it. His front legs were still curled beneath him, but his back legs stood. He lay flopped like a half-pitched tent, bum in the air, and the scrap of a tail protruding from his rear, flip-flipping. He didn't notice his mother approach. He was busy pondering his next move. Olina reached out her muzzle to gently clean her new son with her tongue. The flicker of motherly pressure was too much for his wobbly muscles and sinews to handle. The back legs he'd worked so hard to straighten collapsed. The foal keeled over with a little frustrated puff of air that could only be described as a horse's version of harumph. If horses could laugh out loud, Olina would have. Over the next several hours, the sun rose over the village of Little Geest, turning rosy the just-arriving leaves of the pear and cherry trees. Its glow slid over the fruit orchards till the branches were as red as the round brick clock tower that presided over the town beneath its funny green copper hat. Its warmth seeped deep into the rich dirt, where thousands of tulip bulbs nestled just out of sight, excited for the spring. Tight little fists of plants, they drank it in. And while no one can be certain, there in the dark earth, perhaps the tulip bulbs were excited too. They had good reason to be. Every day they were erupting into rows of color so bright it looked as if a great painter like Van Gogh had left his pallet in the fields. The little foal knew none of this. He'd not yet seen the rich fields of the Netherlands, the land where he was born. Nor had he ever watched those pastures spill out across the province of Flevoland, where the farm of his birth lay between two gentle rises of hill. There, in the stall where he was born, he'd never yet even laid his deep brown eyes on the sun, but he felt its pull. And so, as the world and the birds and the tulips woke up, the foal did his best to make sure he was ready for it. By the time the sunlight slanted over the Dutch door of the barn, he had mastered his 4 feet and gotten all his hooves underneath him, with a few falls and a few more silent mare laughs in the process. But he was slowly figuring out this whole standing thing. When he wobbled, he flip-flipped his stubby tail for balance. When his new knees buckled, he swung out his legs and stood with his hooves in a triangle. Olina moved closer, careful now not to tip her son over, and he knew exactly what to do. He nosed up beneath her and took his first drink of mother's milk. It was just then that the farmer arrived with a pail of morning oats for Olina. He swung open that Dutch door with a creak and nearly dropped the bucket of breakfast. There, before him, was a little foal, arrived nearly a month early, already on all 4 feet, blinking at him. "Ongelooflijk," the man shouted in his native Dutch. "Unbelievable." He stood rock still. Olina shoved her muzzle under the farmer's armpit to remind him that those oats would not eat themselves. He laughed and regained his composure, briefly, dumping the food into her trough. "Good job, my cocoa bean. You deserve it," he said, as he shook out the pail. He turned once again to stare, shocked at the little, perfect foal. "So early and so ready," he said after a long silence, rippled only by Olina's steady grinding of the oats over her teeth. Gingerly, he reached out a hand to gently touch the baby's trumpet-shaped muzzle. The creature flinched, then decided the man's hand smelled deliciously oaty. They smelled good, and plus, the touch was soft. As the farmer cupped his hand under the baby horse's muzzle, the animal leaned his chin into the man's palm with a teensy sigh. "You know what you are? Arrived here first before any of the other foals on this farm," the man said, his sun-crinkled face breaking into a wide smile. The baby horse blinked. "A trendsetter." Trendsetter. The foal thought about it. He'd never heard human speech before and, of course, did not know human language and would never truly know it beyond the emotions that all creatures share. But something in the appreciative tones in the farmer's voice, the look in his face, but most of all, the kind feeling in his hands, felt exactly right. Yes, the foal thought, as his tired, tiny legs began to sway, and he lowered his weary self once more to the soft hay. "I'm Trendsetter." Chapter 2. Sarah. 3,671.25 miles from that cozy barn in Little Geest, at exactly the same time the trendsetter was flopping and wobbling in the hay, someone else was struggling too. On a distant shore on the other side of the broad Atlantic Ocean, far out of sight from the tulips that would burst like flowery fireworks across the pastures of Trendsetter's farm, was a girl named Sarah. And just then, Sarah felt a lot like the little horse, called Trendy, was feeling at that very same moment, frustrated. Trendy, just born, just wriggling to life, of course had no idea that there was a world beyond his stall at all. He certainly didn't know that one day he would end up in a place called New York City, in America, a place that, if it were possible to gallop there, would take a horse like him some 20 million canter strides to reach. 19,392,880 strides, to be exact. He didn't know any other humans even existed beyond, of course, the farmer who loved his mama, Cocoa Bean. One day, Trendy's life would become linked to Sarah's, even with as far away as their lives began. But just as no human can see the future unwind before its time, foals, as magical as they may seem with their extra special velvet noses and broom bristle manes, do not know their fates either. Sarah and Trendy were important to each other, but neither of them knew that yet. But perhaps if young Trendsetter had seen Sarah at that moment and watched her stumbling, trying, failing, just like him, the foal would have felt a little better about himself. It is important for creatures to know that all of us have a tough time, sometimes. To be clear, there, in her family's apartment in New York City, Sarah, a 10-year-old human girl, was of course not struggling to take baby steps in a pile of hay. She was muddling through something different, but it felt no less challenging. Sarah was trying to spell. Sarah's long brown bangs flopped over her forehead as she glared at the tattered old book on her desk. Perhaps if she stared long enough at this, her enemy, this beat-up copy of the Horne-Ashbaugh Fundamentals of Spelling, it would run away in fright. She shook her head at the silliness of the thought, the fringe falling into her eyes. Sarah had given herself the shaggy cut a few days before. She was proud of it, even though her mother shrieked when she saw the choppy, uneven locks and made Sarah promise to never, ever, ever play hairdresser on herself again. The new do made her look more like her favorite show jumper, the Olympian Beverly Woods, the fourth grader thought, even if Beverly's hair was strawberry blonde. A poster of Beverly hung on the wall above Sarah's desk, right above the book she hated so. Sarah took her eyes off the book and looked up at the glossy image. Her scowl gave way to a smile. Astride a chestnut Australian thoroughbred named Amigo, Beverly's look of determined concentration was matched exactly by the look on her horse's face. In the picture, the pair were sailing over a jump at the Olympic Games in Atlanta, Georgia. The competition was called a Grand Prix, though it was spelled P-R-I-X. Sarah's friends at Greenfield's Stables, the barn she rode at on the weekends, had taught her that and how to pronounce the last word properly as prix, just like they would say in France. She had learned that the jump that seemed skyscraper high towered at 5'3". Sarah was tall for her age, and she always had to stand awkwardly in the back row on class picture day. But that jump was taller than she was. Sarah sighed then, much like Trendsetter sighed at that same moment on the other side of the world, contentedly snuffling underneath his mother for his milk breakfast. Looking at the picture made the girl feel better. She loved the pair so much that last Hanukkah, she had begged her parents for a model horse of Amigo, crafted exactly like him by a company called Briar, and now the perfect 1-to-8 scale replica of the chestnut sat beneath the poster on the edge of her desk. It was her prized possession. She reached out and stroked Briar Amigo's smooth plastic flank. If Amigo and Beverly could do something that impossible, if a horse and a human together could fly, surely Sarah could tackle the Horne-Ashbaugh Fundamentals of Spelling, right? But words had always danced across the page when Sarah looked at them, a problem she had been keeping secret from her mother and father, and even from Grandma Frida. Squint and stare at the page as hard as she might, the letters always got jumbled. Consonants and vowels seemed to tangle like the legs of a colt who tries to race the butterflies flitting across the field and ends up in a stumble scramble because he didn't watch where he put his hooves. She couldn't possibly tell her family about her predicament. Sarah's mother and father were writers. Even Grandma Frida was good with words, showing Sarah how to click-clack them out on an antique Scholes and Glidden typewriter. The hulking machine was what Grandma had used to type up her work when she had been a secretary, just like Sarah used her computer, she had explained, during one of their weekly Sarah-Grandma hangouts. Grandma Frida was where Sarah had gotten her love of horses, even though her grandma had never had any horses of her own. Grandma was from Austria, which she called the old country, and her family had been very poor, with barely enough money to afford to eat. They had lived in the city of Vienna, and way back then, milk was delivered every morning because no one had a refrigerator to keep it cool and fresh. Each morning, the milkman would come by at dawn with his delivery, and it was little Frida's job to hand him an Austrian shilling and collect the milk. Though the milkman certainly came early, Frida always beat him to the corner where they met. That is because pulling the milk cart was a Palomino pony. Frida would always save a crust from her supper to feed to the little pony. The pony's name was Modish, and challah bread was her favorite. The milkman was moved by Frida's generosity. He knew the little girl herself had so little to eat, and so once a week he would gift her with a jug of cream. The extra food was a blessing for her family, and her mother would smother Frida with kisses every time her daughter returned, tottering under the weight of the jug. And so it was that Sarah's grandmother, from a very young age, linked horses with goodness, plenty, and pleasure. Modish, the pony, pulling her little cart, brought joy to Frida's family. But in truth, to Frida, it was the pony herself who was the true delight. And she would have loved her and cooed over her as she jingle-jangled her wagon past Frida's home, whether or not sweet cream came along too. Sarah Grandma Hangs were when Sarah felt she could be most herself. When the smell of frying potatoes would somehow take away the rough day at school, the icky feelings of being too tall, too loud, and too bad at spelling. While Grandma cooked, she would plunk her granddaughter at the Shoals and Glidden and recite a story from the old country or a poem like her favorite about a gray pony for Sarah to click out across the keys. As Sarah typed, Grandma spoke, and she would slice a thick white potato super thin, dropping each slice into a pan of hot oil. Grandma Frida called the crunchy slivers pony prints. The golden circles reminded her of the shape of the Palomino pony's footfalls in the Vienna snow. Their favorite poem went like this. I had a little pony. His name was Dapple Gray. His legs were made of cornstalks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.